Good morning. First of all, I thank you, Dr. Mayur Patel, Dr. Shweta Tyagi, and the entire HRLM Foundation team for organizing such a wonderful event. Now, I'll go to the topic, surviving the trauma shock. So, what is a trauma shock management? Trauma shock management is a litmus test for emergency physician. What is a litmus test? Decisive indicative test. It's a decisive indicative test of the competency of emergency physician. So, the one who manages trauma shock well is a competent, a good emergency physician. What are the attributes of the good emergency physician? He requires knowledge, application of the knowledge, adequate skill, astute clinical thinking, meticulous monitoring, and courage to deliver the care. So all these skills are tested in this trauma shock management. Now we'll go to the shock. Shock is inadequate tissue perfusion which causes hemodynamic disturbances and organ dysfunction. In short, there is insufficient delivery of required oxygen to sustain the aerobic metabolism. That's why anaerobic metabolism will start and lactic acidosis. So, this is a trauma shock etiology. The commonest being the hemorrhagic shock. The second, obstructive shock that can just start at pulmonary tension, pneumothorax, then neurological dysfunction, means high spinal cord injury, neurogenic shock, cardiac dysfunction, direct trauma to the heart, fat or air embolism. Why it's important? Why trauma shock? Or why it's important? Because it's the second commonest cause of death. But it's treatable. Brain injuries are irreversible. But this is frequently treatable cause. That's why it's very important to understand the concepts of this trauma shock management. Being a commonest cause of the shock, massive hemorrhages can occur in four places. It's chest, abdomen, pelvis, and retroperitoneum. And from major external wound, means 4 and 1 on floor, that famously called that. And that can happen in elderly patients who are on antiplatelets, dual antiplatelets. They breathe like anything. Breathe like anything. Now, I think this particular chart has came many times today. Just go for class 3 and class 4 because there we require immediate blood resuscitation. Those are very much important. In class 3, 1.5 to 2 liters of blood volume loss. In class 4, more than 2 liters of blood. So, recognition is the key. Recognition is the key, and recognition should happen before hypotension develops. Okay, how to diagnose a shock before hypotension develops? That comes in astute thinking. You need to check for 4 things: tachycardia, narrowing of the pulse pressure, third is increased respiratory rate, fourth is increased serum lactate. Serum lactate is one of the most important point of care testing in the emergency department. Rise in lactate is directly proportional to the mortality. But when we clear the lactate fast, the survival is better. So lactate clearance is very much important. So we have to look for all these 4 parameters. So management of hemorrhagic shock, there are this 5 key principles. One is hemorrhage control, second IV fluids, fluid and blood resuscitation, administration of blood products in appropriate quantity, then use of point of care, assessment of coagulation, then we can use the thromboelastogram. So how the hemorrhage control can happen? In pelvic trauma, pelvic binder. If we don't have pelvic binder, we can use a bed sheet. If there is arterial wound, direct pressure can help. If major arterial wound, we can use tourniquet, and in elderly patient, if scalp is bleeding like anything, we have to do the hemostatic suture or we can apply the hemostatic clips. Fluid resuscitation. When we are giving the fluids, we should give the warm fluid. This particular hotliner or this particular fluid warmer we should available in emergency department, keep in emergency department. So we can prevent the hypothermia. Hypothermia will lead to the coagulopathy and increase bleed. So need to give warm fluid is very much important, and this like this very smart and handy equipments are available nowadays from which we can give the warm fluid as well as warm blood also. Now the Gore directed resuscitation. Administration of more than 500 ml of isotonic crystalloid were associated with worse outcome in patients who don't have hypotension. Okay, if a trauma patient don't have hypotension, we have given the 500 ml of fluid, it has been associated with worse outcomes. So resuscitation should be Gore directed, means based upon whether the patient have hypotension, patient having hypotension or not. Okay. Then this is a caveat. The emergency department crystalloid resuscitation of 1.5 liter or more is associated with increased mortality in elderly and non-elderly patients. These are another study shows that the transition from crystalloid to blood should occur as early as possible, because excessive infusion of the crystalloids, means PRBCs, to the blood crystalloid to BRBC ratio is if more than 1.5 to 1 is associated with higher mortality. So all these study, what they say one principle: blood is thicker than water. Yeah, in literature it has a different meaning, but in trauma resuscitation, early blood is life saving for the patient. Colloids. Now they said that whether we should use the colloids or crystalloids. A systemic review of the trials has been shown that colloids will not improve any mortality or morbidity when we have given in a trauma resuscitation. The tug of war between crystalloid versus colloid get finished with 3 decades of study. They show that there is no difference in crystalloid as well as colloids, but crystalloids are quite cheaper as compared to the colloids. Hence, in trauma resuscitation, crystalloid should be the first choice of this. Now, the concept of controlled hypotension. A growing number of researchers describe aggressive fluid administration as ineffective and potentially harmful, and suggest that limited volume replacement that maintains minimally adequate organ perfusion may improve the outcome. So, we should not bring the blood pressure normal. The concept of controlled hypotension, permissive hypotension is quite important here. What is that? In European guidelines, which is published in 2013, shows that the target blood pressure should be 80 to 90 mmHg until the major bleeding has been stopped in initial phase following a trauma without brain injury. Okay, and it's beneficial in a hemorrhagic shock due to the torso injury, due to gunshot injury or some stab injuries. So how the controlled hypotension will help? Aggressive fluid administration may lead to increase in blood pressure, dilution of the clotting factors, production of hypothermia, which again precipitate coagulopathy, disruption of the thrombus formation, and enhance the bleeding. So when you give aggressive fluids and we rapidly correct the blood pressure, we will harm the patient. But this concept of controlled hypotension, one pitfall is there. If patient having brain injury, traumatic brain injury, in that condition, it's not beneficial. In that condition, we have to keep the systolic blood pressure around 120 millimeters of mercury. So these are the two blood pressure goals. A mean arterial blood pressure should be around 65, or systolic blood pressure should be 90 in reasonable goal for penetrating trauma. Whereas brain trauma is there, then the blood pressure should be, permissive blood pressure should be 85 millimeters of mercury. When we should do the blood transfusion? In class 3 and class 4 shock, we should do the blood transfusion as early as possible. Based what current data says, based upon the current data, we should limit the fluid resuscitation after 1 liter. And if anything we require, then we should go for a blood. Which blood we should immediately, if the blood is available, means we have to give the O negative blood, which is immediately available in the department. Then we can go ahead with the cross-match blood, and when we are giving aggressive blood cessation, we have to maintain the ratio of 1:1:1. One bag of PRBC, one bag of disposable plasma, and one bag of platelets. Why 1:1:1? These two studies have proven that if we give this thing, mortality, patient's outcome are better. Some studies has in between told that we can use 1:1:2 also. But another, this proper study they conducted there, they shows that there is no difference between the outcome. But 1:1:1, we'll say one bag of FFP. That's the reason 1:1:1 will be the treatment plan. So in massive transfusion, we should use 1:1:1. When to initiate massive transfusion? It should not be a subjective decision. It should be the objective decision. There is a score called assessment of blood consumption score, ABC score. It has four parameters. One, penetrating mechanism of injury, focused assessment with sonography in a trauma, if patient's systolic blood pressure is less than 90, and if patient's heart rate is more than 120. Each point carries one mark. If marks are two or more, points are positive. If score is more than two, we have to start massive transfusion protocol. Okay? The same slide. And in emergency department, when we are giving the massive transfusion, we have to look for, we can use the thromboelastogram. We can give the specific parameters when we use this in emergency department. We can save the blood as well as blood products also. Now the transfusion policy in patient without severe bleeding, mild to moderate bleeding, in that condition, when to transfuse? When hemoglobin is less than 8 in normal bed, when there is a risk of acute coronary syndrome, when hemoglobin should be less than 10 that time, platelet should be less than 50,000, then only we can look for this thing. For FFP, INR should be more than 2. And in fibrinogen, if fibrinogen level is less than 100 mg per deciliter, then we can give 10 bags of cryoprecipitate, 5 to 10 bags of cryoprecipitate. Now, the tranexamic acid, yeah, we should use the tranexamic acid, but we should use at right time. Ideally, it should be given within 1 hour. Maximum, we can give up to 3 hours. Within 1 hour, if we give the tranexamic acid, it will save. There is 32% reduction of the mortality. So tranexamic acid, that should be at a right time. What is the pitfall? Tranexamic acid appeared to increase the risk of fetal hemorrhage when it was administered after 3 hours. So after 3 hours, there is no role. 3 hours post trauma, one should not give the tranexamic acid. Best time to give within 1 hour of trauma. You can give up to 3 hours. So when we are giving the tranexamic acid, 1 gram IV over 10 minutes and then 1 gram over the 8 hours. And this will, if you administer it properly within 1 hour, it will reduce mortality by 32%. It's 32% is a very big thing. Role of factor 7A. There is no evidence that prophylactic use of factor 7 in a patient with major injury and ongoing bleeding without documented coagulability. Okay. Autologous transfusion, when we should do, when large hemothorax is there and we can able to recover at least 500 ml of blood, then only we can think. Why? It's immediately available and it's warm and there is no transfusion reaction or risk. So what should be the resuscitation goals? The resuscitation goals, now whatever we discussed, these are the goals. Blood pressure, MAP, mean arterial pressure should be 65 mmHg for a penetrating trauma, and it should be 85 mmHg with the blunt trauma with traumatic brain injury. Heart rate, we have to maintain between 60 to 100. Oxygen saturation more than 94%. Urine output 0.5 ml per kg per hour. Lactate should, we have to bring below 2 mm mole per liter. And we have to check the mixed central venous oxygen saturation. That should be above 70%. The key point is that all this massive, major hemorrhagic shock patient requires surgery. So we have to keep in mind while researching the patient and while achieving the goal, because definitive management will be the surgery. Tension pneumothorax can cause a hypotension, obstruction. So patient may present with tachypnea, hypoxia, unilateral diminished absence of subcutaneous emphysema, hyperresonant node. Immediately we have to do the needle thoracostomy. That we should do in fifth intercostal space. Now it comes, or we can do in even second. If patient is still, we can do in second intercostal space also. This X-ray should not be in department, because one should, this X-ray will not indicate you are a good clinician, because before obtaining this X-ray, you should have done the needle thoracostomy. So if somebody is saying that I have diagonal tension, this is something grossly abnormal. So this should be the clinical diagnosis, and immediately needle thoracostomy should be done, and which should be followed by tube thoracostomy, which will be in the fifth intercostal space, mid-axillary line. Pericardial tamponade, there are many talks about Bextrad, but it appears late. What appears late? Tachycardial hypotension. We have to think. Put a probe like that in previous lectures, so it's very well explained. We should apply the probe there. So the classic finding of Bextrad is a hypotension, distended neck veins, muffled heart sound, that appears later. But if patient having tachycardia and hypotension, we should rule out as early as possible. How to rule out? What is the CCC? Electrical arguments. Okay, this will give a clue. And bedside to echocardiogram, this will also give. So immediately, what is the treatment? This patient should go to the OT. But if you have some time, then you should do the pericardiosynthesis. Pericardiosynthesis should be done in two, using sub-G-pod approach. And now some researchers claim that they can do with the paraapical and parasternal approach. But that time, they should use the sonographic guidance. Fast, yeah, in any patient with shock, we should do the fast, and based upon fast, we should take a decision. If fast is positive, patient hemodynamically stable, should go to the OT. If fast is positive, patient is hemodynamically stable, that patient should go for a CT scan. If fast is negative, patient is hypotension, look for chest and retroperitoneum. If fast is negative, patient in hypotension, patient having pelvic trauma, that time, emergent pelvic angiography and SOS embolization. This critical thinking, crucial thinking will save the patient. So these three concepts we should keep in mind in patient in hypotension while we are doing the patient in hemorrhagic shock. Key point, diagnosis should be, diagnosis of urogenic shock should be made only after all other causes will be ruled out. And if we, after managing every other cause. Pregnancy, yeah, in pregnancy we have to keep the patient in left lateral decubitus, so gravid uterus will go on one side, some inclination should be there, in 50 degrees tiltation should be there, so there will be venous return, and there will be improved venous return, and there will be better outcome. The key point, one should not get distracted by initial good response. And suppose you have got a fast positive finding in patient in hypotension, that don't rule out aortic injury. So we have to think everything, because one major thing is, suppose you have hemothorax, it doesn't mean that patient don't have any pelvic trauma, hemoperitoneum. So we have to look at the patient very importantly, and we should not go in complacence by initial good response. What is the significance? This attribute is required. When lions walk, after walking few distance, you will look behind. Okay, that is called as Sihaulopin. In the trauma, in hemorrhagic shock dissociation also, we need that Sihaulopin. Yeah, we did this thing, BP came up, we should not go in complacence. That's the Napoleon Bonaparte. Initial battle means not a victory, means we have to sustain that initial response. So again, we have to come to the A, B, C, again we have to check the other side, then continuous re-evaluation of the patient. Doing Sihaulopin, that is important in trauma shock management, that is important in managing any emergency, that is important in even life also. Okay, so this particular flowchart, whatever I talked now till now, in this flowchart recognize adult with possible trauma shock, maximize oxygen, establish patent airway, identify and treat immediately life-threatening if cardiac tamponade is there, or tension pneumothorax, needle decompression should be followed by ICD. Cardiac tamponade is there, then we have to do the pericardiosynthesis. Then we must establish IV access to large, more peripheral IV access. Then control hypotension, early blood transfusion,
if hemorrhage control is pelvic binder as well as direct pressure ring, arterial bleed is there, then we should go ahead with the chest x-ray, pelvic x-ray, cervical spine x-ray, and fast and 2D echo I will say. Okay, so evaluation and management should go in tandem. In nutshell, managing a trauma shock can be mastered if we follow these things. 10 commandments, 5 attributes, and 1 message. What are the 10 commandments? Secure the area first. Look and treat the life-threatening causes promptly. Tension pneumothorax or cardiac tamponade, we should look promptly and treat this. Look for the possible bleeding site and control pelvic trauma, pelvic binder, arterial injury, compression. Catch it early. Catch the shock before hypotension happens. How it happened, I discussed in that particular slide. Gore directed resuscitation. If patient is not in hypotension, will you give electrolytes? No. Okay. Then blood is thicker than water. So, only one liter of blood, then we should go ahead with the blood transfusion. Okay. Control hypertension in absence of traumatic brain injury, we have to maintain mean arterial pressure of 65. In presence of brain injury, we have to maintain mean arterial pressure of 85 mmHg. Early blood resuscitation, when we are giving 1:1:1, there is no other protocol. ABC, objective scale to take a decision about massive transfusion protocol. When ABC score should be more than 2, correct. And use thromboelastogram and tranexamic acid. One should use a tranexamic acid. The tranexamic acid should be used within first 1 hour. It can be used up to 3 hours. But after 3 hours, it will increase bleeding. Okay. So, 5 attributes. Aggressive evaluation and management. Right intervention at right time. Astute clinical decisions. Meticulous monitoring and evidence-based practice. Updating the knowledge is very important. Meticulous monitoring of the patient is quite important. Astute clinical decision, this is very much important. These are 5 by 2. These are not required in trauma management. They are required in managing any emergency. And one message. What will be that message? Just dare to care. Thank you.